Inner Traditions Audio presents Julius Evola, The Philosopher and Magician in War, 1943 to 1945, by Gianfranco de Turris, read by Luke Bob Robinson. Foreword. Following the Trail of History, Giuseppe Parlato. At the present point in time, the literature by and about the traditionalist philosopher Julius Evola is quite plentiful. There are studies that touch upon every aspect and phase of his life, from the period of his youth to the Second World War, and which deal with facets of his work ranging from the purely esoteric and philosophical to the essentially political. Despite this vast literary production, however, a biographical and historical study that specifically addresses one of the most delicate, difficult, and overlooked chapters in Evola's life has been absent. And this is what Gianfranco de Turris has finally achieved in the present work, which is based on previously undiscovered or unconsidered documents. The time frame under consideration here stretches from July 25, 1943, until the mid-1950s, when the philosopher was faced with the absolute necessity of political action and when his first post-war works were published. This is a span of less than 10 years, yet these were clearly not normal years in the least, neither from the perspective of what had taken place in Europe and in Italy especially, nor with regard to the possibility of recovering archival material that could show in an irrefutable manner what the various geographical journeys and political events experienced by Evola were, as well as his thinking. De Turris's great achievement has been to successfully document, with scholarly precision and to the greatest possible extent, all the obscure details, conflicting reports, and distortions that relate to Evola's complex itinerary of during and immediately following the Second World War. One of the main difficulties has been that of documentation. Although Evola was particularly reticent and reserved about his own personal and political affairs, de Turris has managed to successfully follow his historical trail through these years, unraveling the knots and tying together the loose ends to clarify matters and shed light on what is false and what is true. First of all, the itineraries. The author has minutely reconstructed Evola's journeys from the fall of fascism to the initial post-war years. The first journey was to Berlin in August of 1943, shortly after the philosopher had concluded that the conditions for carrying out a fascist plot to free Benito Mussolini were futile, and besides, no such plan existed in the first place. Evola would then travel between Munich, Berlin, and Hitler's headquarters in Rostenburg, where he lived and was present for the founding of the new fascist state, along with Vittorio Mussolini, Alessandro Pavolini, and Giovanni Preziosi, until the following September, at which point he returned to Italy and to Rome. Once there, he would refuse an invitation by the Ministry of Popular Culture to move to Salò, instead remaining the entire time in the capital until the arrival of the Allies. At this point, he again took the road heading north, following the retreating German troops, first to Verona and on to Lake Garda, then to Vienna, always in contact with or working for the German military secret services. This brief period was intense with activity, and de Turris reconstructs it with remarkable precision, so much so that sometimes it has the feel of a detective novel filled with all sorts of encounters and events, misdirections and diversions to avoid capture, false names and historical protagonists. In Vienna, we have the tragic and well-known incident that took place during a bombardment of the city. De Turris manages, for the first time, to pin down the event chronologically and, moreover, to give the exact and scientifically demonstrated details of the trauma suffered by the philosopher as he was walking across a square in Vienna during an airstrike, and the impact of a nearby bomb explosion threw him into a wooden scaffolding in the center of the square. He would remain paralyzed in his lower limbs for the rest of his life. De Turris meticulously reconstructs Evola's long and painful hospitalization, first in Vienna, then in Hungary, and finally in Italy. In Italy, he was initially in the province of Varese and later in Bologna, where he remained hospitalized for about 3 years. During this time, he was also able to take note of the internal commissions of the communist patients who would eventually replace the nuns caring for other patients so as to counteract the religious propaganda of the church. Evola would finally return to Rome in 1951. All of these experiences and occurrences, geographical, historical, and medical, as well as those relating to espionage, are analyzed by de Turris with great care. This passion for detail is fundamental in order to proceed through a minefield of available and scarce documentation, some of which has led to misleading interpretations of the past. Without wanting to preempt the author's innovative and, to some extent, surprising conclusions, I would like to mention three key points of his research, seen in a historical light. The first is the judgment Evola held of the Italian Social Republic, RSI. This was well known to historians, but is substantiated here with great clarity. Evola totally disapproved of Mussolini's choice to establish a republican state after he was liberated from the Gran Sasso. He felt that even if a king does not merit respect due to his behavior, this is not a sufficient reason to dissolve the institution of the monarchy and introduce a republic, which constitutes a dangerous yielding toward the masses and nullifies the autocratic power that is, for Evola, the essence of traditional sovereignty. Even worse, Mussolini's republic was also social. It declared itself to be committed to social politics and founded on popular consensus, which is, according to Evola, dangerously open to populism and far away from that sense of aristocratic authority that he considered the only requirement for power. Most importantly, he justified such concerns by pointing out Mussolini's profound rancor toward the king, who had duplicitously had the Duce arrested, thereby dissolving the 20-year-old power structure known as the Ventennio. Rather than a republic, Evola would have preferred a Mussolinian regency so as to avoid disrupting the continuity of the monarchical institution. In reality, Evola knew well that all this was not the mere fruit of improvisation on Mussolini's part, nor did it lack antecedents, for it was the case that during the fascist regime, the Roman philosopher had contested precisely these aspects of the fascist administration of power, ascribing a large dose of the doctrinal responsibility to Giovanni Gentile. For Evola, the redeeming aspects of the Italian Social Republic were its chivalrous, legionary, and military expressions. For example, its young adherents who were determined to fight to the end with honor and who felt it was their duty to defend the fascist idea in the now divided nation, even if it meant sacrificing their lives. For this, they deserved respect. On the other hand, Evola had been convinced since July 25, 1943, that the situation was now compromised, and therefore he did not limit himself to writing but wanted to be engaged in operational activities with the aim of maintaining loyalty for a commitment that was first ideological and second human. However, it is significant that the philosopher may have refused the offer of a transfer to Salò to instead remain in contact with the German Secret Service, for which he had worked in a cultural capacity on a research project, a political endeavor that seems unexpected both for its duration and for the moment in which it was conceived, to study the various forms of Freemasonry at an international level.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.